happened in the
actual game, and it's sort of like. It looks to me to Fabulous.
And the Geeknight and the organizers, all these people who are really working hard to make it happen over the month. Might be we are facing it only today, but they are really taking their longest throughout the month for making it happen. And one more thing, I personally wish to thank Sridhar among the organizers because he's the one I interacted first and he's the one talked to me in all these ways. And I really thank you all. And finally, and once again, I'm thanking you all for coming. And yeah, let's begin. So about me, I'm a UI developer. focusing on the further technologies like JavaScript and Angular. My favorite one is Angular, and I do a lot of stuff there. And I have some 5 years of experience in developing web applications and hybrid mobile applications using Angular and JavaScript too. And I'm also actually contributing in the developer communities like GitHub, Sitecore, and all those things. And that's all. So, it's about our topic. It's, anybody can learn Angular. Actually, the title is sponsored by one of my
friends, Josephine. I thank her too, because I was quite confused about the title. So, Angular is like, okay, before stepping into that, I just want to, how many of you are familiar with Angular, the framework, working professional who are working on Angular or expertized in Angular? Nobody? AngularJS. Oh, there are some people, then it's quite difficult for me. Okay, the session might be too, what to say, it's like a KG session for you people, those who know about Angular. But others, it will be very helpful because I am talking from the beginner level. As a beginner level only, I am taking the session. And if I am talking something wrong or anything you are not understanding or you feel like, okay, this guy is talking something wrong, and just raise your hand, stop me and correct me, or if you have any questions, just again raise your hand and ask questions. We can go like that, okay? End of the day, you are spending your time, 1 hour of your perfect evening, so I just want to make sure that you learn something. So always welcome to stop me somewhere. So about Angular, whenever you're going to learn something new, there must be these 4 questions in your mind. What, why, where, and how. These 4 things must be, you should ask yourself whenever you are going to learn something new, whether it is technology or whatever it is. Why? Because if this question doesn't come to your mind, you should ask yourself, what is this and why should I learn this? What is the use of this and where can I use this? Okay, the same, I think many of you ask this question when you're learning integration and all those things in M2, M3 and all those subjects. And so what is Angular? Angular is like it's a front-end framework. It's a front-end development framework. Front-end is like, what to say, a web application. Take about a web application. There will be 2 sides. Basically, there will be 2 sides for any web applications. There will be a front-end and there will be a back-end. Front-end is the part where we are visualizing, we are seeing. For example, if you are going to the Flipkart application, the view we are seeing, the products we are seeing, and all those things are called front-end. And the backend is the thing where this data, the data of what we are seeing is stored in the backend. So Angular is used to create develop applications, the front-end part of any applications. And there are many famous applications which are running on Angular. So that's Angular, and why Angular? So, and some more explanations, like it's a front-end framework, and one of the main advantage why the Angular is so supportive is it is sponsored by Google, it is maintained by Google. It's created as some normal developers, some enthusiastic guys. Later it is pulled by Google and they are maintaining it. Since it is open, it is an open source application where people like us, we can contribute there to Angular and we can add our own features, then we can extend it. And also it's a single page application, it follows MVC architecture. So these things I can tell you when we start coding, when we start looking into the coding sessions. And it is written on JavaScript. JavaScript, I hope you all know that every web browser runs on JavaScript. Whatever it is, I think from the Edge in Internet Explorer to other, all the web browsers, it runs on JavaScript. JavaScript is the only language which is addressable to web browsers. And Angular is written on JavaScript. End of the day, it will be compiled to JavaScript and it runs on the browser. So that is the basics of what is Angular, and then it's why we should use Angular. Angular is not the only framework, it's not the only famous framework which is available in the market. React is there, Vue is there, Backbone is there. There are so many other frameworks are there, similar frameworks which has almost similar functionalities. Then why Angular? Angular comes up with out of the box many components. It's not like components like which we can view and we can make use of it. It's components for developers to create, to make our work easy. So it helps a lot for developers mainly. Then the material design support. Angular has its own material designs which we can drag and drop and it will be working. And its DOM manipulation will be easy. DOM manipulation means what to say? you are browsing internet and you are clicking a button, some actions happens. So that is called DOM manipulations. That kind of set of actions, a number of actions which results in a big results, that is DOM manipulation. It is very easy with Angular, which also I can show in demos. And the packages and the wide support, the developer community and the packages are very wide for Angular. So at the year of 2009, we can get anything. We did not to write anything from the scratch until and unless it's a specific particular feature. Others are everything, it's already packed and it's available in the internet. We can just grab it. And it's supporting for testing, inbuilt support for unit testings. Then the mobile and desktop support. It's like, what is it? We are opening the web application. We are opening one application, the Flipkart website in desktop. The same application we are opening in mobile browser. There, in desktop, there will be pointers, and in mobile phone, there will be our touches will be there. So both the things will be works the same, as expected, the same behavior. There will not be any delays or anything. So that support also providing Angular. So then the next thing is where Angular is using. Okay, this is one of the main part of Angular. So where Angular is using can be defined only when we know about what is a web application development process. What are the phases of developing a web application? Then only we can completely realize where it is actually used. So from a developer perspective, the web application has mainly four phases. That is called the UX design, the UI design, the UI development, and backend development. These are the four phases of web application development from a developer's perspective. There are many other things. There are business logics, there are documentation, there are architectures, and all these things are there. But that is not completely coming to a developer. It will be taken care of by managers and other business analysts. All these people will take care of those roles. So, but this is the main role for a developer. So we can talk about Flipkart itself. It's a familiar application which all of you know. about starting the Flipkart. Thing like one fine day, the Flipkart owner just woke up. He was not an owner of Flipkart now. He was just a normal guy. He just woke up and he got an idea strikes in his mind like, okay, I need to create an application. I need to create an application which sellers can sell their highlight their product, and the customers, the buyers can buy their product from there. And I will be acting as a mediator. I will create an application for act as a mediator, and I will earn a lot of profit from that. So that was his idea one day, though he created a lot of business logics. He discussed with his friends and all those things and created documents and a lot of things he did. And finally, he is coming to a software development company like ThoughtWorks or one company he is meeting. And the first thing, he will express his ideas. He will express his business logics and all those things he will be expressed. Then what happened? Then they need a design. They need a design to show us, show the customers what is their product. So what they'll do, he will talk to a, then the UI design, UX design is the phase. So he will go to a graphical designer or a UX designer where he will sit with him and he will start sketching the outline. So how my app should be look like. So there should be one page, it hosts all these products in cards, and there will be one another page when we click on the product, all the details should be displayed. So these number of pages will be created as a in the UX design phase. So the output of this phase will be images or wireframes. And there are some software tools which you are used to for developing. These are Adobe XD, Sketch, and many other things like Illustrator, Photoshop. Even Photoshop is also used. Some there are many wired frameworks for this. So output will be images. And what we need to do, then the design will be go to UI design phase. So what happens in the UI design is it's a HTML conversion. These images will be converted to HTML. So literally what I'm talking is, let me go to the website itself. Sorry, one second. Okay. So what happens if we take a screenshot of this page? Okay, that is UX design. Literally, that is UX design. There is no interactions. There will be a simple image that tells what should be where. Okay, that is UX design. Then what happens is this will be converted to HTML pages. Okay, think about we are going to buy Samsung. Okay, this was a image. Then this is converted to HTML page. HTML page means there will be buttons, there will be cards, and all these things will be written in HTML code. Why HTML means? HTML is the only supporting language in browsers. If you need to show something in interactive way, then it should be HTML. So we're converting that to HTML. Then there will be these buttons and search bars. Everything will be there, but there is no interactions. Okay, so what should happen when we click on this buttons, or what should happen when we click on this input tab? That is what the phrase called UI development. Okay. That is also a phase called UI development. In UI development, we give definitions to all the elements in an HTML page, like buttons, search bars, or cards, or whatever in a page. For an example, if you are browsing Facebook and you are clicking on the ad friends or the notification button, what should happen? A small pop-up is opening there, right? That is the UI development. Then the data will be collected and stored in the backend, the tables, the data tables. That phase is called backend development. So where this Angular involves is, it's in the UI development phase. So the guy completed his design, he completed this HTML design, then he integrating this code, the interactive phase is called Angular, where that is the phase where Angular involves to the show. So Angular will be responsible for all your actions. Whatever you are doing in a website, that is, Angular is completely responsible for that. Getting your data, getting your actions, or storing your data for temporary storage, then sending it back to the database, getting data from there. All these things will be maintained by the single framework. That's the phase an Angular is actually responsible for. So I think now it's clear that where should Angular use? It's in the UI development phase, and it can be also used for building standalone components. And one another bigger advantage of Angular, which other front-end frameworks does not have, is the hybrid mobile development. Even React also have React Native, but the involvement of Angular with Ionic is very high. What is Ionic? Ionic is a language which we can use to create hybrid mobile applications. Hybrid mobile application, like we can code once and we can create an app using app for iPhone and Android. So that much with a single code. That is Ionic, and Angular is the main code base for Ionic till the last version. But in the latest version, there are some more codes added, but still Angular is the base code for Ionic. So that is also one plus advantage of learning Angular. And how to use Angular? How to use Angular is I can show you in the codes. You can also add your own things. And these are some building blocks of Angular. So whenever you are appearing for an Angular interview, or whenever you are starting to learn Angular, whatever you are doing with Angular, these things, the first things are the basic building blocks of Angular. Every Angular application will have this by default, or you will be using it with or without knowledge. And the other things are just the additions in the latest versions, which to make changes based on the latest technologies. Okay, so these modules, components, directories, data binding, in dependency injection, templates, routing, and services, which we can learn, which I can explain you once we start coding, so then it will be easy to understand. Okay, so that's all about the primary definitions. And the environment setup. For running the Angular application in our local machine, we need some prerequisites. Some means only few. Just Node.js and the GitHub. It is optional. That's not necessary. But the Node.js, it's a server. It's a local server. Maybe professionals, you might know about the PHP server, these AMP servers. Like that, it's a Node.js. It's a local server which must be installed in our machine to run Angular. And the IDE is like, it's a code editors. Why we need code editors means, for example, we are editing a document in Microsoft Word. We can edit the same documents in Notepad or any other language. But why we are going for Microsoft Word? Because it has some default features which makes our work easy. So the same thing we can get from the some other IDEs or editors. One of the famous one is VS Code, Atom, and Sublime. My personal suggestion is go for VS Code. That will be that it has many supportive features like extensions and all. And just installing the Angular. That we can see in that next step. So these are the basics of Angular. These are what these are the answer for the four questions: what, why, where, and how. So now we can start installing. Now we can start coding. Then we will get more doubts. You can ask more doubts or anything which is not clear. You just ask me. We can go clearing that. Okay. So first of all, we need to install Node.js. Okay. So these links I will be provided in the chat box. Okay. So Node is like a local server. We need to download the latest version. It's not stable. This is the 10th version is the stable one. You can download it. You can install it. I already installed it. So once Node installed, we can open our command prompt and search for Node version, and we can see the versions. Okay, it's 10.10.10.10.0. So this version is installed. The next thing we need is the Angular CLI. So this is the official website of Angular, which we can accessible. This URL is angular.io. So it defines everything from the basic, from the scratch to complete creation of an application. It is defined in the website itself. You can also consider it as a reference after while working out in local. Okay. So in this website, if you go for getting started, there are two examples. Either we can start with an app, creating an application step by step. We can follow and create an application. Or there is one more thing is we're setting the environment and we can use it our own wish. Okay. So I am going with this. So they itself saying that we should install Node.js. Okay. So I installed it. It can be downloaded and installed as a normal application. And the next thing is installing Angular CLI. Okay. So what we should do is once the Angular is installed and the version is verified, you can just copy this command and you can just paste it here and press enter. The Angular will be installed. Okay, I'll tell you why this G is. What this? Okay, is it visible? Okay. Why this G stands for? It's for global. It's once we install, we can just install npm install Angular CLI. It will be available only in that folder. You cannot create an Angular application in any other folders. But if we add G, minus G, then it will be installed globally across the system. So you can create an Angular application in any folders. So that's the difference between Angular global and normal Angular. Okay. So now the Angular is installed. The Node.js, we installed Node.js, we installed Angular CLI, and now we are going to create an application in just two steps, okay? With two commands, we are going to create an application. So this is a folder, open any normal folder in your laptop, then open the command prompt. Then you can simply type, before that, once the Angular CLI is installed, you can search the version by ng-version. When you search for that, it will display you the version of the Angular install. It's 8.3.6, which is the latest version. Angular 9 is going to release in November. Okay, so this is the latest version. It's installed now in my machine. Okay, after that, I'm going to create an application. It's a command ng new Geeknight. Okay. So when we give this command, Angular is setting up an Angular. It is asking us some questions, some basic questions to create an application. The prerequisites for creating an application. The first one is, do you need routing? Routing is something which navigating one page to another. Okay. For an example, in the Flipkart website itself, we saw some many options like, there are electronics, TV appliances, men, women dressings, and all those things. We can go into now. I am in Samsung page. Then I am going to the list of MA mobile phones. This process is called routing. The navigation from one page to another is called routing. So Angular is asking me whether my apps need routing. Yes, obviously. Then it's asking about the styles. Which style format I'm going to use. So initially there was only CSS styles, but these days there are many other styles, SCSS, SISS, less than stylus. Why? Because CSS is quite complex. When we start writing styles in CSS, it will go long and long. It will go pages. By using some other SCSS, SSLS, we can write conditional styles, which was not available for a long time, but now it is available in the market, and we can integrate directly with the Angular application. But I am going with the CSS now. So when we give S, it will create an application. It will run a set of commands, and it will be creating an application, and it will take some time. It will be running, and it will be creating some. It will take some couple of minutes to finish the process because it is pulling some 230 MB from the GitHub and installing the applications. So far, I was talking for like 10 minutes or something. And any doubts or anything which you are not clear, because we are about to start the coding session. So before that, doubts. Yeah, please. Does Node.js is enough. No, nothing else is needed. Okay, I can. So he was asking about what's the difference between single page applications and the other applications. That was a good question. So I almost forgot it, sorry. Okay, so this is the website of Angular, and we can also go to some other website like, this is a Mozilla developer website. It is really a good website for web developers. It provides all the explanations in detail. Okay, the thing is, when we are navigating in, now I am in technologies, I'm navigating to a HTML page, you see a blinking of the page. Okay, when I click on CSS, the page will load again. Okay, but when in Angular, when I click on routing, there is no refreshing, there is no loading of the page. It is just showing and hiding something. Okay, the difference is when we go to, there's an option, when we go to the network, okay, and same time I'm going to the network here. Okay, I'm traveling from CSS to HTML, then you can see it is takes some 549 KB of memory. But when I'm traveling from this Angular website, it's some 344 KB. So what happens is, again, I am going back to CSS. Okay, now it's 603 KB. Then now, okay, it's loading and loading and loading. Then again, I'm going back to HTML. See, again, the same memory. Again, it takes the same memory, okay. But in Angular, what will happen? I'm going to managing data, then again I'm going to routing. So again I'm going to managing data. There is no memories loaded, okay. Then again I'm going back to routing. That time only there is some memory loading. So what happens is there is no page reloads. There is no page reload means it saves a lot of time in loading all these resources. That is called single page application. There will be only a single page, and all the other pages which we are seeing is just showing and hiding. It is actually loaded in the initial loading itself, and it is hidden. Okay, when we are moving some action, it's just hiding the current view and showing a new view, rather than loading the entire page. That costs a lot of memory, in that results in the time. See here, you can see that about 3.6 is going and going and going, okay. 8 MB, it's stored, loaded in 8 MB. Then I'm going to some mobiles. Then again, some 5 MBs. Then I am coming back to the home page. Then again, the page is loading from the starting. So that's the difference. That is single page application. That is the advantage of Angular. It takes only less memory, and it will be more efficient. So our application is created and it is pulled out from the Git, and the size of the application will be the size of the application is 16 MB. Oh, sorry, it's some 230 will come. Yeah, it's 240 MB, the size of the application. This memory is downloaded from the Git as based on the selections we made. Okay. Other than that, any questions? Yes, please. Yes, yes. Okay. So JavaScript is there. It's a core language. Java and JavaScript are the core languages. Okay. There are many frameworks written on this language. Okay. Ionic is one framework written on JavaScript. So, and Angular is one another framework written on JavaScript. In recent days, the JavaScript is it's very open. We cannot restrict. It is very difficult to do a object-oriented coding in JavaScript. So one more language is created from JavaScript called TypeScript. In TypeScript, we can do object-oriented JavaScript, that we can create modules, we can create OOPS concept and all of lot of things in TypeScript. So what they do when these new frameworks came, they, instead of using directly JavaScript, they started using TypeScript for the easiness, for the security and all those purposes. So like that, but end of the day, anything which should be run, it should be viewed in the browser, it should be, it must be in JavaScript. Everything will be converted to JavaScript and will be displayed in the browser. Is that clear or? Angular uses TypeScript, actually. Initially, Angular is like, it's something built on this thing, right? But the what we are coding will be TypeScript functionalities, TypeScript directives, and all those things will be writing on TypeScript. It's a language. Angular is a framework written on this language. Framework means it has many other default functionalities. Like what to say? It's a frame, like a thing like a simple photo frame. If there is a photo frame, what we'll do? We'll simply take your photo and put it and place it on the wall. Instead of that, we cannot think about like simply pasting that photo on the wall. The difference will be there, right? Or think about like we are creating a framework ourselves from buying wood and cutting and all those things. There will be a lot of time difference. So that is a framework also. The same thing is a framework. We can simply start coding with that. So that's our app of size 230 MB. And this is what when I open my application. These are the folders which will be inside an application when we simply run that one command, ng new Geeknight, ng new, whatever your application name you want to give, whatever it's, it, this is the, these things will be comes by default, okay? So I am again getting inside the folder. And to run this application, I need one other command, ng serve and hyphen hyphen off. This is to open the application once it is completed building. Okay, so now the application will be started by default. And I just want to have a question. So how many professional developers, software developers who are currently working? Okay. Okay, there are here and there. Okay, students? Okay, a lot of students, okay. Any faculty, staffs? Nobody, yeah, okay. Okay. So students, what do you understand from the class, the things I talked for last couple of minutes, 20 minutes? Or you got some idea about a framework, or what is a framework, or something like that, or you're okay with that, or you need any explanations more? It's okay, because once I stepped into the code, then it will be really hard to follow up, because I was not aware that this much students are here, story. Okay, so this is our application loaded in just two commands. We just installed Node.js, we installed the Angular CLI, then we installed then we created one application called Geeknight, then we run the application, we got this screen, okay. This was the, that's why I said Angular is so simple to learn. Angular is equally complex. It runs on many other very big websites. Even our Gmail is running on Angular because it's Google's. Google want to advertise it, so they use it for Gmail. Okay, Gmail is running on Angular. Many other bank applications are running on Angular. But the same time, it is very easy to learn or very easy to start from the scratch. In just like this, in just two commands, we can create an application. So like this, this is our first application. This is our basic homepage when we run a basic application. And you can see that when I click on this, when I click on this Angular material, there is some changes here. So it's telling that how to install these commands. And when I click on this add dependency button, there is the changes here. Then I click on this build production, there is some changes here. So let me show you one change. I will add one change to the DOM. This is called DOM manipulation. Okay, this process is called DOM manipulation. That is something we are doing in the DOM. This is the DOM, document object model. Something we are doing in the DOM, there should be an action here. That process is called DOM manipulation. Okay. So I'm going to add one more button, and there should be some changes here. So, okay, this is the Visual Studio Code software, the IDE, which I was telling about to use. I'm just importing my application. It's really simple. You just need to open the folder, and we can select the folder. Our project will be added here. Same, our project is added here. To download Visual Studio Code, you just need to search for VS Code, and it is available here in their official website. And it's obviously it's free for usage. There is no need to licensing or cracked versions or nothing. You can just go to their website, you can just download it and make use of it. Okay, so I open the project in my IDE in VS Code. And before explaining all these things, I'm directly going to the code. So this is the HTML which we are seeing in the browser. There's a lot of things. And see the new component which you see there. Zooming. Just trying. Okay. Okay. So the new component, Angular material, add dependency, all these things are added here. Okay. These are all added as buttons, and I am adding one more thing. So we can give some names. Geeknight, and what should do when I just made some changes in the code. Okay, and you can see one thing. Whenever I'm making a changes, this is the place our application is running. Okay, this is the prompt our application is running. When I am adding a space here or something here, and when I'm saving, you can see that there is some changes happening here. So our application is compiling its own. It's auto-compiling. Whatever the changes we are making in the code, it is auto-compiling and it is displaying on the browser. Okay, so I added one button called Geeknight. And when I click on the button, it is available here. When I click on the button, you can see a message that it's happening. So I just want to show you how simple to manipulate the DOM in Angular. Okay. Okay, for one application I created for a sample, I'll show you. You can also run as many applications at the same time. The only thing you need to give is you need to mention the port. Okay, It's already running on the port 4200. It's already running on the port 4200. So I cannot again run the same application on the same port. So next time, what should we do is we should add one more command, one more line like # port, then some other port number. Okay. Then what happens? The application will be running in a new port. Just wait for 2 minutes. So it's clear, right? To create an application, downloading the Node.js and getting the website. Okay. So the second application is running, and it will be, there will be some 120 modules or something. So this is one application, one sample application I created for our demo purpose. So there will be some products displaying. When you click on the product, the product will be displayed here. So you can notice this place, this URL, you can notice here. Okay. Okay, initially, when I'm in the landing page, when I'm in the home page, the URL is like 4210. So when I click on the products, a list, the URL is added to hash list. When I click on a buy button, the URL is details. So the view is changed. We are navigated 3 pages, but we didn't see any refreshes there. That is called single page application. That is the advantage of single page application. This process is called routing. For this navigation only, they asked initially itself, do you do routing in your applications? Okay. So first of all, we can create a, we can replicate the same application. In our, this is our current application. We can replicate the same of here. Okay. So some basic things to make our application development process easy or designing process easy is Bootstrap. So some of you will be heard of Bootstrap. Bootstrap is a, it's like a package. It's like a dependency. The use of this Bootstrap is to make our website responsive. Responsive is something like we are viewing a website in our desktop. The same website we are viewing in a mobile phone. There will not be any feature. None of the features will be hidden. It is compatible for the mobile phone and the desktop. Any size of the screens, the width of the screen doesn't makes any problem to the application. So that is possible through Bootstrap. Not only Bootstrap, there are many other packages like that. But one of the most famous one is Bootstrap. Okay. So we need to install this Bootstrap to our application to design or code in the Bootstrap also. For that, there is some packages provided by Bootstrap. I can tell you one thing. So now we are dealing with this part. Okay, we are going to code an application, create an application. We will cover all these parts. So dependency injection is the part where we are adding Bootstrap. This is an external dependency. We are going to add it in our application. So this part, this is the place we are going to cover it now. Okay. So once we are going to Bootstrap website, you can see that npm install Bootstrap. Once you install Node.js, you can install any packages using npm. So the same way you can also install Bootstrap. But the only problem is there is one dependency for Bootstrap also. jQuery is similar. It's a program. It's a DOM manipulation language like JavaScript. It's a quite older language. So jQuery is needed for installing Bootstrap. So we can install. We should install both of them together. So this is a prompt which is running our application. So I'm stopping the prompt. So npm install Bootstrap latest and jQuery. Okay, I'm installing both, and I'm added one more line called -- save. That means the packages will be installed, and the same time the reference for these packages will be saved in our code also. Okay, while the packages get installed, I will explain about the code structure. Okay, we can talk about this part now. These are the contents which install when we run that, when we create an application, okay? So what is this E2E? E2E means end-to-end testing. I said that the Angular by default supported testing purposes. So this E2E is responsible for that. Today we are not covering that. These non-modules, non-modules is a place where all the packages or all the dependencies. Now we are installing Bootstrap, right? That Bootstrap will be saved inside these non-modules. So for the Java developers or people like you are working on other technologies, like the jar files, it's like the non-modules. Then this is a source part. Source part is a place where we add all our steps, our codes or styles and whatever we are working on, we'll be adding in the source part. Then there is edit configuration. Edit configuration is for if you're working as a team and you are configured your machine with all the best configurations, you can add that configuration in the edit configuration, and other teammates who are working on Angular take this file, and when they run on it, that configuration will be by default come to them also. Like this, the Geeknight file. Geeknight file is dependent for GitHub. Then this angular.json file and this packet.json file. These two files are the most important files in the Angular application. So once we open this packet.json file, you can see that there is a lot of dependencies added here. Dev dependencies, normal dependencies, and a lot of things are added. These are the references for the packages which is available inside these node modules. Okay, whatever you are adding here will be installed inside the node modules. Why? Because we can go to the folder. So this is our application. We can check the size of the application. Okay, it's like 245 MB. The application size is 245 MB. So what should we do? We can omit these node modules. Without the node modules, we can check the size of the application. It's like 676 KB. Okay, without the packages, it's only 676 KB, the application size. So what we should do, if your friend is asking this application, what we will do? We should give it with the node modules or without node modules? Without node modules, right? So that's why we need packet.json. So everything is installed in the node modules is available in the packet.json. So what happens is you can give this code without the node modules, and the when your friend take the code and run this code, he just need to run npm install, then all these packages and dependencies will be installed in the node modules again. Okay, so that is packet.json. though similarly, there is one more file called angular.json, which includes all the basic configurations of of these applications. Okay, initially we can see that the output path of the build, the styles which is added, all these things will be referred in the angular.json. Okay, so now our Bootstrap, it is installed, it is finished, and we can see that in the node modules. So you can see that Bootstrap is available here. Okay, we installed using an application, we installed npm installed, and it is available in the node modules. And what we should do is to use Bootstrap is we need to take this Bootstrap min.css file, copy the relative path, and open our angular.json file. Angular.json file. This is a styles. Okay, can reduce the size to make it easy. Okay, this is a JSON file. You can add it here, just above the style.css. Okay. And in the script, you need to add one more thing. Again, go back to the Bootstrap module. Every packages like Bootstrap, which will have a CSS file and a JS file. CSS file will have all the styles. JS file will have all the functionalities. Okay, So you need to add both the files. Just copy this relative path and paste it here. And we saw that we need jQuery also for this running this bootstrap. So we are going again and searching for. Okay, jQuery file is here. We are going here. There is no CSS file for jQuery. We are copying the path of jQuery and we are adding it above the bootstrap. Okay, so now our application will have bootstrap is installed in our application. So I'm going back to the our command, our prompt, and running our application again. Okay, so it's installed here. So I'll show you what's the advantage of added that bootstrap file. Okay. So we are going to the bootstrap website and there will be some components. Okay. Here we can take the header of. So our application is loaded again. So this is there is a navbar available in Bootstrap, and what we are going to do is we are just going to copy paste the navbar from there. Okay, I just copied the navbar from here. I am going our app component HTML. I am deleting all these basic stuffs and I am installing it. It's loaded again and we can see that the navbar is available here. Okay, we didn't add any styles or any external features. We simply installed the bootstrap and we just copy paste the components from there and paste it. Okay, like this we can add any of these features provided by bootstrap easily without having any problem. So this is one complex navbar. Okay. I'm sorry? Okay. Sorry, I didn't see it. Thank you. So I just copied the set of codes and it is already available here. So that is the advantage or that is the use of these external libraries in our application. This makes our life easy because instead of creating these things from the scratch, we can simply add it and copy paste and go it. Okay, and now we have a header. So what we need is we need to create a page like a page for the listing the products. So we need to create a page like this. So for that, what we need to do is we need to create one more component, okay? For creating a component, there is a shortcut for Angular that is called ng-generate-components. ng-generate-component and the component name. So we can add this like a product listing. So when we give that command, we can see that there is one more folder added in our code structure, that is list, and there is again this HTML, CSS, and command prompt, this TS file. Okay, this HTML file is the place where we need to add our contents, like we added the header, right? This is the place where we need to add it. The CSS is the place where we will style it. We can add some custom styles. And this component.ts, this is the file which we write the actions. Where should go or what should we do when we click on the buttons or what should we do when we type something. These things will be added in the component file. So here I am creating a basic structure. It's a bootstrap basic structure. You can follow it. maybe because of time, maybe we can copy paste the structure. Okay. Okay, this is the basic structure. What I am telling is to display the cards, I am using this one, not this one. Okay. Okay. So what happens is this. This is structure for showing that products as cards in the page, and we need an input data. Okay. These are the list of data. The format of this data file is called a JSON file. So here as arrays, I added some 10 lists, the mobile displays we are seeing, right? I added those data here, the name, the link to the photo, and the minor description and the price. So I'm going to create a variable here. Yeah. Okay. Tell me which one is suitable for you. Okay. Fine. This one. Okay. It's really difficult for me. I always use black screens. So somebody asked, what is TypeScript, right? This is TypeScript, actually. The component, the coding we are typing is in the format of TypeScript. Okay. So I'm creating a variable. It's of type any, and it's an array, okay? It holds array values. Okay, so we have a list of 10 items. We are going to display in the page. So typically what we will do, we will take all these items and we will write like here we will have 10 sections and we will add each section the name and the price separately. But by using Angular, we need only one section. We can make use of some directives, okay? That is one other concept which I showed in the PPT. This is a directive. Angular always have ng directive. That's why Angular is always known as ng framework, or like ng events. Whatever related to Angular will be said as ng. So because Angular, the directives are started with the name ng. So there is a directive called ng4. What ng4 will do? Typically what a for loop will do, we all studied in the basics, right? For loop, it will repeat the loop until till the array's length of the array. Okay, like that. Our array is product list. This is our array. Okay, this is our array. And it has some 10 products. It has some 10 products with this. And each product we can repeat using the directive ng4. Okay, and we are declaring a variable. Let x, y, z, or anything, ASD or whatever it is. For a naming convenience, I'm giving it as product. So let product of product list. That means, if product list has 10 values, this section, right, this from here to here, you see, from 4 to 12, this section will be repeated 10 times if product list has 10 values. And each instance of the value will be available in the product, this variable, okay? Don't confuse with the names. I'll give x, y, z. Okay, this is just a variable, and each instance of the product list will be available in this variable x, y, z. So what we need to do to display all these things, we need to display it as okay, before this I'll hide these things, and this is called a data binding. This is string interpolation. This is a kind of data binding, which is one of the basic building blocks of Angular. Okay, that we are displaying the data here. I'm taking the each instance of the product list and displaying here. So right now we need to display that content in our home page. So where's the editor? Oh, it's okay. Now in our editor, app.component.html is displaying there. This is the header, the code for header. It is displaying there. This is our component, list component. So how we are displaying the contents in the list component to the app.component.html. So for this, we enable routing. Already we enabled routing. We need to do some codes in the routing module. So there is a module called app.routing module. This is a module responding of traveling from one page to another, navigating from one page to another. So, okay, it's a little time, I think. Okay, so this is the routing module. I will copy paste the codes because of time. These are the routes we should mention here. Okay. So this is the part we should mention our nav views or navigations. For adding a component in the route, we should import first. Okay. We are importing our list module. It's like a list component, I guess. List component from the file. From the file, when we click on /, we can see the folder. We can go to the folder again. We are giving a /, then these files will be loaded. We just add list.component. So see the difference. While using an VS code, we can always make visible the files available. If you are coding with some other IDs like a Notepad or something, we need to type everything from the scratch. So that's the difference of using a IDE. Okay, we added this component. Now we need to mention a path here. So it's again a data structure. It's like a path. List, then one more variable called component. Okay, by giving this, we are navigating a we are adding a component, and this is the basic selector for showing it in our view. Okay, so now again we are in the landing page. The path is empty, so we are giving the path list, and see our JSON, the data is we given, right? It is there in the path list, because the path we are given there is list. Now the view is not good, but we can see each data. The data are 10 times, and 1 second, I'll change it. I changed the color of the ID and it's confusing. Okay, see, our JSON file has 8 elements, 8 rows, and these are the 8 elements available here. You can see it one by one. Okay, the data is there, the ID is there, the name is there, the image is there, everything is there. What we are printing is XYZ. That is the instant of this product. Okay, so what now we need to format the data. And I give. Now what we saw there was this name, trailer, image, description, and everything that was available in the product JSON. Okay, so to specify those data, we just need to put it in a double curly braces, then the instant dot that name, dot name or image. If you need to fetch image, you can mention it as product dot image. Okay, so now I saved it and it's running. So it's like the view is not good. 1 second. Okay. So the data will be visualized here like this with our minor changes in the DOM. like this. This is like a, this is the one advantage of this directive. NG4 is the directive we are using, and we are handling some set of 10 set of JSON of having 10 datas. Like this, we can handle any number of JSONs very easily without much DOM manipulation. See, we did not write a single line of code here. Okay, this is the data. This is the data which we added. Other than that, there is no other codes we have written in the JavaScript file or the TypeScript file to make a display like this. So we can, the DOM manipulation is not that dependent to the script file in Angular. So that was the easiness of DOM manipulation. And we can also do one, if we click on this file, we can navigate to the detail page, but I don't know, we have time for that. Yeah, might be 5-10 minutes. Yes, yes, that's right. Done. I can complete with the questions. Maybe if they are interested, I don't know. Okay, so we can wind up with this, and if there is anything in my PPT. So I just covered without your knowledge, dependency injection, data binding, directives and components, then routings, not services and modules, but templates also. So these are things I covered here. Maybe you are aware. And one last thing is the environment setup. Okay, fine. These are the basic bookmarks, the links which we are used here, the file structure, the CLI, the building blocks, the Git repository, and okay. So he's asking me to go out. No. Okay. So these are the basic repository. I said like Angular is an open source, right? So this is a repository, GitHub repository. This is the main code of Angular, the code of the main framework. Okay. 70, there are 997 contributors other than Google. So you can also clone this repository, download this repository, add your changes. You can raise a pull request. If it is good for the developers or if it is some innovative things, they will merge it. And you can show it in a resume and get a job or whatever it is. Okay. So that is one thing. And about the developer community, I just showed the GitHub. And there is one more community called Stack Overflow you might be known about. There will be a lot of question and answer sessions will be going on there. So we participate actively in these communities rather than just sitting down and doing some task assigned to you. Explore the web, explore GitHub, explore Stack Overflow, explore all the forums, explore the blogs of Angular and JavaScript and everywhere. Whatever you can learn or whatever you can search, you do it. Get a knowledge, get updated yourself because it's something, because I commonly we hear that people will say that don't go for some IT guys because they are saying that there is no future. After 5-10 years, there are not future. Mostly, there is a common saying. But it is because we are limited. When we are working, we are limited to our particular task. What is the task assigned for us today? So we are completing that and we are going home. But rather than that, explore this framework, explore this GitHub, Git, and all those things. Then get updated yourself and there will be more options for you. Okay, so any questions? Sorry. Ask me the questions first because they are looking at me. we can. I send the main website itself. Okay, he's again asking to go out. Okay. The Angular website itself, I can show. Just 2 more minutes. Yeah, yeah. When you go to this application, you can just click on the Get Started, your first app. There will be step by step. Okay. If you follow all these steps, you can create an application in 1 hour, which is much detailed explanation than I give. So that is one option. And also, there is one Git repository. Maybe I will add in the comments. There are some 20 applications, basic applications built on Angular. You can check it out. You can add your changes. And you can continue. Any other questions? Yes, yes, please. Yes. 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 Yes, yes, we can change it. We can change anything we want, but we need to again sit down and analyze each file. We need to change a lot of places. Okay. No, there is no CLI. Means when it is once it is built, we are writing codes on based on that language, right? Because we are writing codes based on CSS, it will be quite different to convert that to a CSS. And also in the building process, there will be some when we select based on our selections, some internal building commands are already preset. So that we need to change. We can change, but it takes some 1 or 2 hours based on the size of the application we created. And anything else? Please ask me some questions here. Okay, so that's all. Done. Okay, then learn about Angular more, explore the things. You can contact me in, I have a small website. It's not a personal advertisement. Okay. So there's a website, because instead of sharing all those things, yeah, this website, you can go there, you can see a lot of links here, LinkedIn, Stack Overflow, GitHub, or a lot of things. You can contact me in anywhere, and if there is any doubt, and if you found something you did not take it right, you just write to me. It will be very helpful for improving myself. So you can go to alexistobi.in and explore those things. And if you want to contact me also, you can find a link there. So that's all. Fine. Okay, so I am winding up. Thanks again, ThoughtWorks, that's the team, the Geeknight. Very thank you for me. Thanks all.
Thank you very much, Alexis.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot. It was a good presentation. People, we just have a small announcement to make from Kaleshwari. She's a developer in ThoughtWorks. I'll pass the mic to her.
Thanks, man.
Hi, everyone. So ThoughtWorks is doing a program called Vapsi. It is an initiative to help women who are on a career break and they wanted to restart their career. So it is an initiative to help the tech industry to be more inclusive in terms of diversity and fill the gender gap. This is the actually main reason for doing this program. So what it takes for a candidate to attend this will be like, she should be a software developer who has at least 2 years of, so minimum 2 years of programming experience prior to career break, and minimum 1 year of career break. And should have good understanding of any programming languages, object-oriented programming languages like Java, .NET, Python, any object-oriented programming languages. So the program, how it works is, it will be a resume screening followed by a code pairing round, which will be held in the office. Most cases, if it doesn't work for any valid reasons, it will be conducted over Zoom or any other medium. Then the selected candidates will go through a program of 4 weeks of boot camp, where they'll be given good guidance and support and to improve their skills. And the selected candidates will be selected for a six-month internship program in ThoughtWorks. Followed by that, they'll be given an offer in ThoughtWorks based on the performance. If do spread this word, whom you think would benefit from this program. So, thank you.
Okay, the much awaited break is going to be now. Before that, please come back in 10 minutes. So we have so much to demonstrate to you after the break. So the snacks are available inside the cafeteria. Please help yourself.
finding solutions to coding problems and enhancing programming skills through the attendees were encouraged to follow the extreme programming technique of pair programming, where two of them team together to work side by side and continuously collaborate and learn from each other.
check once. I am Ashok Gautam. I work for ThoughtWorks. I've been an application developer for 7 years here. And I was working on a variety of things during these 7 years, starting from a desktop application, web application, and later moved on to working on the IoT space, building firmwares, hardwares, and we built multiple things for the office as well. So this talk is going to be about what we did in the IoT space and the related things within ThoughtWorks Coimbatore. So in ThoughtWorks, under the name of IoT, we worked on different things. So I have categorized the things into projects, workshops, the capabilities that we developed during that session. And also we'll go through a quick demo of what we have. Is it visible? So we worked on multiple projects, and to mention a couple of or few, these are the ones. So we worked on something called energy monitoring. This is for the KGISL college campus, where they have multiple buildings, and for each building there are quite a lot of electrical equipments that draw power. They wanted to gather data about where the energy is being spent and optimize the energy usage. So that involved creating a wireless solution because the buildings were spread out across the campus, and we cannot keep running Ethernet cables around the entire campus. The wiring cost itself will be way too high compared to the rest of the implementation cost. So we went with a wireless solution where we just deploy small devices near the main power board that will integrate with the meters there. So we had to replace the energy meters they used with a meter which provided the data as an API, so that our modules can gather that data and send it over to a central location. And we collected those data, made it available like for a longer duration, so that we can see the history of the data, compare and visualize it. So then in ThoughtWorks Coimbatore, initially we were present in the KGISL campus. We had the office in the KGISL campus, which was a very small one. Then later we moved here, started expanding in the side area, and then here we have expanded. While we were in the KGISL campus, we explored creating modules which we can deploy in the already present switchboards, such that we will be able to control the lights. So what came out as a effect of that was we were able to expose the lights as an API, so that anybody can programmatically control it. That was the first step on the IoT journey. Then came smart integrations, like integrating the light with something else, so that multiple things work together. Like for example, in the meeting rooms here, we have a PIR sensor, passive infrared sensor, which detects human presence. And based on that, we automatically turn the lights on and that solution was completely developed in-house. As part of this project, we decided for the new office that you people are sitting not to have switches at all for the lights. So you can look around, you won't see the switches for these lights. And even in the meeting rooms, we don't have switches to control the lights at all. That was a bold move that we took while designing the space itself. We just asked the electrician to wire the lights as if they would never be turned off. Just wire it with the main board. Don't even worry about the switches. We will put one. And that actually saved us rather than costing more to make them smart, it actually costed less to make them smart. How? Because we don't have switches. We don't have to run the wires from the roof to the edge of the room and then down again to the switches. So the wiring cost alone saved in the order of 1 to 2 lakhs for this space. Then the modules that we developed, we installed in the rooms as well as near the lights that you are sitting under. And whatever started as just controlling the lights also evolved into a much more complex project where we started developing hardware modules like these that you see here, which will have multiple sensors and actuators, which we can show, I mean, which gathers the data, and that data can be collected in one place and made available as an API. So anybody who wants to use this data and do something, any thought worker, they can just hit REST APIs, get JSONs and work with those and start writing interesting solutions that make use of the data that we gather from this one. So this particular module contains like various sensors, passive infrared sensor that detects a human presence, a noise sensor which detects how loud the surrounding is, doesn't record the audio, just how loud the surrounding is. And we have a IR sensor, IR LED, IR blaster basically, a brightness sensor, a proximity sensor just to interact with this one without even touching this, and a small display as well, and the usual temperature, humidity and pressure sensors. So this made it possible to create the office workspace itself as a platform where people can come and start developing solutions that now includes data from these kind of sensors as well, without even having to touch a sensor or know about how things work there. And just listing the projects that we did, we also worked on implementing a face recognition based access control system. So when entering the office, we swipe the ID cards and then enter typically. And in addition to that system, we also have a face recognition based entry where registered people will be allowed access without even swiping a card. They just walk in, the door unlocks, they enter the office premises. For this to be done, we had to integrate with the existing access control systems, which we explored and found that it's hard to do, as well as it was not like secure in the first place. So we went ahead and wrote our own access control systems with the same assurance that we give for client projects. We made it secure and safe to use. So this access control system is more like a pluggable system. It can work with plugins, and it works or talks over MQTT as the protocol. So any other module or device that we want to connect to our access control system, all that we need to do is make it talk MQTT protocol. It's the protocol used in IoT space for communicating between devices, just like how we use HTTP in the web browser world. So on the capabilities front, We worked on IoT, machine learning, image processing. We used Google Cloud Platform for some of the things initially, then later moved everything to in-house processing. So everything that I'm talking about now is all self-hosted. We don't send the data over to the cloud to make things work. So on the IoT front, there were multiple things involved. First thing, we had to work with electronics. It's not pure software anymore. And writing programs for hardwares, which is like writing a firmware. And we also had to explore what are the options available in the wireless space so that we can choose the right solution for the right problem. So we went, we worked on these technologies like Bluetooth, low energy, Wi-Fi, and NRF24 is a common term for radio modules which use a 2.4 gigahertz frequency for communicating at a lower level. It's not same as the Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, it's actually a level lower than that. Which means it incurs much less costs in terms of battery power as well as complexity. It's pretty simple, like you send the data, it basically get shouts in the 2.4 gigahertz frequency. Just like how we have a speaker and a mic which sends the, creates the sound and receives the sound. Similar to that, these modules just create noise in the 2.4 gigahertz frequency and also receive the same noise in the same frequency. So using that, you can make devices communicate between each other using this device, this radio module. And we also worked with multiple microcontrollers like ESP32, 8266, Arduino Pro Mini. There's a variety of Arduino devices, and we specifically chose to work with Arduino Pro Mini because of its footprint. It's pretty small. And we started exploring STM microcontrollers so that we can even handle higher complex workloads. So far, it's basically a much faster microcontroller options. On the platforms front, for the IoT ecosystem, we used Home Assistant, which solved quite a lot of problems for us. It has a plugin ecosystem and a good set of plugins where you find ways to integrate to anything that you can think of as of now. MQTT, NRF, Google Alexa, or any API for that matter. And we used MySensors for the wireless communication. We explored other options like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, etc. But we settled with this one for its simplicity as well as lower cost. And we also started integrating things with Amazon Echo. It was getting pretty popular, and we wanted to try our hands on those as well. So, end of the result of that, the same lights that I said can be controlled using APIs can also be controlled using voice. It's basically just APIs now, so you can start integrating with any device that you can program. And we also ran workshops in and around Coimbatore. We started conducting IoT meetups, although it's not pretty frequent nowadays. We should keep continuing that. And we ran a few workshops at GHC, Forge Factory downstairs, and I don't know why Rust is here. Okay. We also offered internships to college students, and they got exposure to electronics and IoT and embedded programming as part of the projects they worked on. The energy monitoring access control, I missed talking about effluent monitoring. That was also another proposal that we pursued and worked on. So interns were primarily part, interns were the primary people who were part of these projects. So now we'll talk about the wireless switch demo that I was mentioning. So here we are using the NRF modules to communicate between the devices, and we use a framework called My Sensors. So NRF modules look like these. So pretty small one. Can you put up the video on this one? So these ones look pretty much like Bluetooth modules or Wi-Fi modules, because they work on the same frequency range. They use the same antenna. These are called NRF 24L01, and it costs like 20 to 30 rupees each. This is just a radio module. You need a microcontroller to connect it so that you can start communicating using this. And the My Sensors framework, the My Sensors framework has multiple components. So it requires four things to make a functional IoT device. So the first thing is the microcontroller, which acts as the brain of the device itself. And that is the one that we program, add in our logic and make it talk. And the radio module is the one we use for communication. And sensors and actuators are the actual core components that sense the surrounding world or give out information to us. The software and firmware is the other part that is required for making all these things work together. So there are multiple microcontrollers that we can use with the My Sensors framework. So on the Arduino variants, these are the three things that have support for My Sensors. And there are also other microcontrollers which are supported. These are the ESP32 and the ESP8266 work out of the box. There are some STM microcontrollers which can be made to work with My Sensors, although they are not officially supported. Okay. Sensors. So these are the different sensors, just to mention a few, that can be used with this My Sensors framework. So My Sensors framework takes care of the categorization of data. Like, you can specify, I am sending a logical Boolean value, and it can be used for representing door closed or open state, light on or off state, similar things. Basically, all the two state data can be represented using that. There are also support for temperature, humidity as first class elements. And there are also other complex data that we can send, like structured data, that any custom data that you want to send using this framework. So we also need some software or software to develop the firmware, and Arduino IDE is well supported for this purpose. There are also other tools that we can use, like Platform IO, which is a command line equivalent, which aggregates over all the tool chains that we see. Arduino is just one of the tool chains that Platform IO supports. Expressive for the ESP variants is the other set it supports. Okay. So, back to the fundamental question. Can a bulb become smart? Can a normal bulb become smart? If no, Why not? If yes, how? So it all depends on how we define smartness, right? What can we call smart? We don't expect the bulb to start talking, for example. So connected to the internet. Why should it be connected to the internet? Okay. So anything that we want to connect across locations, we usually use internet, and anything that we want to control like from a different location, the logical option is to connect it to the internet. Connecting to the internet is not the only requirement for making something smart. It needs to have some proper use case. Like you cannot just connect the bulb to internet and say it will just keep glowing irrespective of whatever happens. Okay, let's see what can be done. So this is how conventional electric bulb is wired. We have the 220 volts main supply which is connected to the bulb. If you just connect the phase and neutral lines to the bulb, it starts glowing. Simple as that. Now we just take the phase line and introduce a switch. So with this switch you will be able to control the light. This is the normal common switches that you find. So this is the wiring which makes the bulb be controlled using a switch. So the switch is connected in series with the bulb, and whenever you change the switch, the bulb toggles. So to make the bulb controllable with another circuit, all you need to do is make something that behaves like a switch and put it in the place of a switch. Simple. So let's say this is an electronic circuit that behaves like a switch. Then right away we can replace an existing switch with this circuit. How do you do that? You simply swap out the switch for this one, assuming it behaves like a switch. So what is this electronic switch made of? It's basically it contains a relay which is the actual thing that controls the power supply through that line, either makes the contact or disconnects it. That's all it does. How does it know when to do that? Based on the signal that it receives in one of its pin. It just has three input pins, two for its power supply for it to operate and one for its signal. If you give a signal of high in that line, it toggles. If you again remove the signal, it again toggles back to the original state. So the one that you see on the bottom is the Arduino Uno, a very common microcontroller development board. It can be any microcontroller board or a raw microcontroller itself that we can use. So what we saw here is simply an electronic switch. You program the Arduino to do a blink. If you just run the blink example that comes along with Arduino IDE itself, it will make the bulb blink automatically. Instead of blinking an LED, we make the mains bulb blink. How do we start controlling it from, say, a laptop or a mobile phone or some other interface? We add a radio module. We just make connections from this one, the microcontroller, to the radio module, and burn a program that makes use of those. Immediately the electronic switch becomes a wireless electronic switch which we can control from some other device. So this is exactly what we did. We expose these light bulbs as an API, which means you can control it from another remote or a laptop or a basically anything that has a browser. Okay. Can you put the video on the screen? Third one, right click. So this is a radio module that I was talking about, an NRF based radio module, and this is a module that we built here, which contains one of those, and the one below is the Arduino Pro Mini here, and some more components here to make it run out of main supply instead of we having to power it with batteries or an adapter. So these are the entire components needed for making a module that can convert a normal bulb into a smart bulb. We see the microcontroller, the radio module, the relay, and a power supply to make this thing run. And all that we expose here are two interfaces. You connect the main supply to one of the connectors. You take the main supply out from the other connector and connect to whatever you want. It need not be just a bulb. It can be even anything else, like a fan or some other device. So this is the framework I mentioned. mysensors.org. It's the home. This is their site. So to build a wireless device on our own, all we need is the three components that I showed, and there are like good documentation present here to get you up and started. So in the getting started, you can see the steps to create your own IoT device. So this is how an entire circuit would look like when using this framework and these modules that I showed. All you need is a microcontroller, a radio module, and a sensor. It can be a sensor or a relay for actuating. So what you see here is the entire wiring that we did here in the board. Earlier we used to have hand soldered components and deploying that manually. We still deploy it manually anyways. Now we used services available online like JLCPCB to build the hardware, get it prototyped quickly. Then we started implementing the built device and started controlling. So this is like the third version that we built. And so there are also the relay modules available as an individual breakout module, where it's easier to connect to 220 volts AC. You don't have to do hand soldering yourselves like this. So the modules supported by my sensors are these officially supported ones. I don't know, you know, which some many of you might have been familiar with, and Arduino Nano and Pro Mini are the smaller counterparts, and the radio module that I showed. All of these components are available online for purchasing. We used to purchase this from AliExpress, where we get these for really cheap costs. So the entire module that we built, these ones, it only costed like 600 rupees for the complete module itself. And this design actually controls only one light per module, but you can keep scaling it for how many other pins you have in the microcontroller. Like one microcontroller can control up to like 8 devices, 8 lights directly. So there are variety of sensors available, as I said. All of the sensors have some common interfaces, like you give the power supply 5 volt and ground, and then one or two pins where you connect the digital pins from the microcontroller. You either send the data to the actuator or receive the data from the sensor. So to get started, all we need to do is install Arduino IDE, include a library, go to sketch, include library, and in manage libraries, you can search and add my sensors as a library. So that is the step that brings in the my sensors framework to your Arduino IDE. Then you will find all the examples available in the menu under my sensors category. So here you can find something called a relay actuator. So this is the exact code that we directly flash into these microcontrollers and run. For Arduino Uno, it will be pretty simple to flash a program. It has all the required USB interfaces. You just connect it to your laptop and then you can start flashing the code. For other smaller microcontrollers, you need another device called a programmer or a FTDI cable, which will be used to program these ones. So if you're new to electronics or IoT, I would suggest going with an Arduino basic one, so that you don't spend time figuring out how to program and all. So the relay actuator code looks like this. So there's nothing like really there for me to change here and show you. It's the same code that we are running. So the Arduino sketch file will have the example file will have the relay pin, which is the pin number that we have to configure where we are going to connect the relay to. Other than that, the default settings, just default code itself will take care of controlling the light. So this is about programmatically controlling the light, like the module that controls the light. How does that module know, or how do you communicate to that module? You need another module that speaks the same interface, which is the NRF 24 radio frequency. So for that, there is another device called a gateway, which you can either build, again, very similar to this one. It's the same wiring that you do. Instead of connecting a relay to the microcontroller and the radio module, you just remove the relay, and the same wiring you do another copy, and that you can use as a gateway. So whenever we call something as gateway, it will have two interfaces. On one interface, it will here in this case it talks NRF24, so that it will communicate with the other node. On the other side, it will communicate over some other protocol or medium. So we chose to go with an ESP 8266 based gateway, which will have NRF communication on one side and Wi-Fi on the other side. So that gateway is just one thing. You don't need to build a gateway for every light that you want to control. You just build one gateway. You build multiple nodes. These are called nodes, which go near the bulb. And you just put the gateway in the center where all the nodes are visible. And these radio modules have like a kilometer range. If it's not surrounded by any concrete walls or anything, If there are walls like these, like you find here, it has a smaller range, like in the order of meters, like tens of meters. So we are able to like connect these lights using a single gateway. So you can find the gateway. You can find the gateway code that you have to flash into the gateway microcontroller in the MySensors examples itself. There are multiple gateway modules, multiple microcontrollers that you can use as gateways, like ESP32, 8266. You can also use another Arduino Pro Mini, sorry, Arduino Uno with Ethernet breakout module, if you can find one. Nowadays, people go with Wi-Fi commonly, so we went with that one. Although you can avoid using any other wireless medium if you want as well. So the gateway will be connected to an IP-based network, like using Wi-Fi or Ethernet cable. It will be connected to a network in which the gateway will be visible as yet another device with an IP. So using that gateway, you can have a program that talks to that gateway and controls the lights. And fortunately, we don't have to write softwares for that. There are many available. For debugging purposes, there is a MYS controller, Windows-based application, which can show all the logs and allow you to program the microcontroller over the air also. And we have also written an equivalent of MYS controller using Rust language. It's called MYS controller underscore RS, written by one of our fellow thought workers called Satish Thangavel, and it's in his GitHub account as well. That exposes these nodes as APIs as well. So using that, you can write apps or services that communicate to these devices over APIs completely. We can also go with Home Assistant, as I mentioned earlier, which has plugins available for working with this one. And Home Assistant, it's pretty easy to configure. All you do is include the plugin and write a couple of lines to configure the node alone. It's just YAML content. There are like ready-made things that you can take and move forward. So the Home Assistant, UI looks something like this. So this is the same interface we use to control the lights around the office here. So the light that you see here behind me is exposed here, and all that we do is just put one of these modules above the light, connect it, and add a small configuration to Home Assistant, and Home Assistant automatically deducts new nodes as they get added. The configuration that I mentioned is just to customize the text that you see in screen. Otherwise, it just deducts the new nodes automatically getting added, and immediately it's available for controlling. Home Assistant is like a really quick run and start using kind of a software. So we also have some automations written in Home Assistant where we control the lights automatically. Whenever the sensors that are present in the meeting rooms get triggered, these automations kick in and control the light. So the light is literally not hardwired to the sensor. It goes through these APIs. So we have a central place where you can even turn on or turn off an automation. So for example, we even turn off lights automatically at 9 p.m. to save power. Any questions so far? Sorry, I need the mic. I'm not able to hear. No, they are not. It's only connected to the local network. It's not visible over the internet. So there are two reasons why these lights are particularly not connected to the internet. One is our internal security team's restrictions. We cannot make things visible over the internet without going through an exhaustive security process. Other thing is, we literally didn't need to. Why would we want to control the lights from outside the office or home or wherever?
So one more question. It doesn't have an internal power supply, right? So in the case of a power out, imagine that the default state is off. I on the light. So does it have an option to remember what was the state before losing the power?
So these microcontrollers that I showed you have two kind of storages. Basically, all microcontrollers have two kind of storages. One is called the ROM, which you flash the code to. Other one is called the EEPROM, where you can write data to from within your code. So there is a persistent storage where you can save your light's state, and the default code actually does that. So it maintains the state across restarts also.
Okay, fine.
So whenever we turn on the light, it stores the status immediately to the EEPROM. And even if it goes through a power cycle, whenever it boots up, it reads the EEPROM and restores the light status to the same state.
Okay. So in the case of an RF, right, how do you uniquely identify? So RF is basically receiving it, right? So how do you uniquely identify the light in that case?
So the MySensors framework already takes care of that. Each node will have a unique node ID.
Okay.
It's just a number. Like 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. till 255. So every time you boot a node, after flashing its code, it immediately asks for a node ID from the controller. And if you are using Home Assistant, it will automatically allocate the next available ID. So the first time I turn on this module in a fresh network, it will get assigned an ID of 1. The next module that I boot up will get assigned an ID of 2. And Home Assistant will start showing the IDs like these. So every item it recognizes, it will use the ID and show it automatically. Then we can configure it to use whatever names we want.
Just out of curiosity, one more question. If in case if there's a gate failure, do you have a failover mechanism to handle that scenario?
Right now, we don't.
Okay.
We are planning to have two different gateways, one for this side of the office and the other one for the other side, so that we can segregate the networks. But other than that,
okay.
We don't.
Fine, thanks.
Just for clarity, the MySensors framework supports it.
Yeah.
You can have multiple parallel gateways also, just that we are not using it.
Yeah, as Ashok mentioned, it's an in progress. Probably when you come to next time, it'll be there when to have failover.
And the MySensors framework supports mesh networks as well. It's just a feature toggle that you one line of change in the code that I showed, where you can enable repeater mode for individual nodes. So those nodes also start behaving like another gateway. So that way, you can even reach farther distances. Even if you have a very huge space, you can configure a few repeaters in the perimeter of the range. It will get the range will get doubled basically. Any other questions? So we were planning to show a hands-on wiring stuff and couldn't get it done on time. And even if we had one, it's no different than what you saw just now. It's basically going to be like a ball of wires here, and it's the default code that we are going to burn in. The only thing that I didn't mention or show about is the programmer that we used to flash the bootloaders. So these modules that you see here have the code flashed into them. There's also something called a bootloader present in every microcontroller, and that bootloader is responsible for supporting over-the-air updates and all. So if you want your code to be reflashed without having to take the modules from the roof, then you need a way to do that wirelessly. So that support is provided by the bootloader. The bootloader will get the new firmware binary data and overwrite it and then reboot. And all that can be done using APIs. The MIS controller that I mentioned allows you to do that. I leave the components here. If you want to take a look after the talk, you can take a look, and we'll be around. If you have any questions, feel free to reach us. And as usual, we are available on all our networks. Feel free to contact us. We are planning to run the IoT meetups again, kickstart them again, and yeah, feel free to join them as well. We saw more like interest in the IoT space since a couple of Geek Nights. So we would also like to connect with the community and take this forward. So do join us, and we will be running the community meetups in the weekends sometime soon. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, everyone. I think we're on time or a little over time. You know, as Ashok was saying, you know, it's these days it's very easy to rapid prototype these kind of boards and fabricate it yourself. You know, there are various services available for you to design and print it in a matter of like days. Right. You ship them the, you email the, or no, upload your Gerber file, and you will have the board shipped to you in like a week's time. It's very interesting times. You know, these processes used to take months or no, or super expensive, not too long, like few years back. And these are like super cheap. Like you can get like 10 boards of these things for like 500 rupees. Or if you include shipping, it is probably 1,000 rupees. Yeah. It's anyway. So thanks for coming again to Geeknight. And hope. You had takeaways from today's session as well. And as you might have noticed, if you have been to any of the previous Geeknights, we are trying a few things different. You know, we had form-based registration instead of pen and paper to speed up some of the process. Similarly, we also are going to have an email-based feedback this time. Hopefully, it will not stop you from sending, sending us feedback, but of course, anything that you would like to talk to us, you can just walk to us and we can have a discussion right away. No problem at all. And as I was telling, if you have been to the last Geeknight, so this particular one is a bit special. So this is our third anniversary, by the way. We have been running Geeknight continuously for like 3 years now. And so it's like third anniversary for ThoughtWorks Coimbatore as well in the city. So I mean, we've been doing Geeknight right from the first month that we have been here. I don't know whether you have participant coming for the all the way to the 3 years. Yeah, there you go. There is one. Yeah. Do you want to talk about your experience in general, like how it has been?
So my name is Karthien. So I work at Coimbatore company called Trustees. So the primary motive why I want to follow up all these meetups, especially Geek Nights, so it's like every time, I'm not regular, but at least, you know, I'll try to make whenever it is possible. So the one core thing you get to see here is like every time you get a new experience, be it not just in technical, of course, you get to meet a lot of people, you get to meet, you know, a lot of other part of this, I mean, what to say, the people from the same, you know, community, or, you know, when I say tech community, so people try to solve a different problems, so you get to discuss all those things that will enrich your ideas, like, you know, you'll be doing this one thing in a routine way, but that is being solved by different people in a different way, even a smarter way. So those things are, you know, really giving a motivation for me. And of course, like ThoughtWorks, these guys like always host us very well. It's always a pleasure to be here. So I hope everyone will consistently participate, you know, spread the knowledge and gain more ideas in future meetups as well. Thanks.
And there's, you know, when good things happen, it is like all happen at the same time, right? We also recently hit like 3,000 people in a meetup group. And we are like 3,035, this is the biggest tech community in Coimbatore, right? So, and you know, it's glad to see the response from the community back, right? When we came here to Coimbatore, the community scene, or the meetup scene was like very low. Like, you know, I used to talk to other organizers of other meetups, it has been like very hard to get like consistent like 5 people to meetups. So in that sense, we are glad, and we take pride in, you know, getting this community together, and, you know, having all of us here. So anyway, I'll not take long. You know, it's already too late. Thank you for coming again. Hopefully you will come back. You know, this event happens every month, third or fourth Thursdays. You know, in the last few months we've been doing it on and off on third or fourth, but yeah, you can stay connected in meetup.com and you'll get notified. I do have like another announcement though, sorry for taking more. So next month, of course, we do have Geeknight next month as usual, but there's one more event. So this is in the process of making, there's no literature yet. So October is popular for this particular thing. There you go. You want to talk about, anybody want to talk about what October is? It's okay. Okay, so it's a movement that is happening worldwide, you know, focusing month of October for contributing to open source, right? So this is a time where people encourage others to contribute to open source in any form, you know, it's not necessarily code and software, it can be documents, it can be bug reports, it can be, you know, even spelling mistake fixes, like anything that you can improve and contribute back to open source community, or even design work, any of these things, right? October is a month where it is encouraged, and we get more people into the habit of, you know, contributing to open source. It's not that you only contribute in the month of October, but you start the activity in the month of October, right? Mm-hmm. And we have been, you know, we've been fan of October in ThoughtWorks, and this year, to sum it up, next month, almost each of our office across various cities in India as well as globally is organizing a day to get people gather and help them started into contributing to open source. So in Coimbatore, probably it's going to be happening on October 12th, the Saturday. I'm just looking for my calendar. Yeah, so basically, 2 weeks from now, right? Yes. Right, October 12th, it's a Saturday. We'll publish the date and the event details. It's going to be happening right here in the same place where we are. It's going to be a day-long event, unlike evening. It's going to be on Saturday. You know, in the event, what we'll do is, like, you know, get us familiar with the ways of contributing to open source, the benefits of, you know, contributing to open source, and the outcome of contributing to open source that we get, right? And we probably pick a small problem statement, small areas, and we do contribute to open source on the same day. It's not that complex. We'll do that. So we'll publish the event again in Meetup, same page. You'll get to know the details, and I just wanted to let the people here know about it, that it is coming up. And that's it. Anything else that you want to cover?
Just have to go into that link and then the same process to give feedback. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time.